My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat. Thank you to all our lay leaders here present to accompany our priests who are going to renew their priestly vows today. Today, I would like to focus my reflection on something very essential to our identity as Christians. The oil for anointing, which we bless every year. In Greek, it is called Chrisma, and the person being anointed with it is called Christos. I know that we have gotten used to using the term Christ as a name. Some people even think of Christ as the surname of Jesus, Jesus Christ. Thanks to Mel Gibson's movie, The Passion of the Christ, The Passion of the Christ, not The Passion of Christ, The Christ. Now we know that Christ is not a name, but a title. It is the title we give to Jesus when we confess Him as our Lord and Savior. Jesu Christos, Jesus the Christ, meaning Jesus, the Anointed One of God. The other English title, which is the equivalent of the Greek Christos, is Messiah. And I think I have told you before that it comes from Hebrew, the Hebrew word Mashiach. At yun ang origin ng Espanyol na salitang masaje. In English, massage. Sa Tagalog, masahe rin. Ang minamasahe kasi nung unang panahon pa, nilalamisan muna. Ang boksingerong inihahanda para sa isang labanan, minamasahe muna. Ganyan din daw sa mga sinaunang sundalo. At ganyan din ang ginawa sa mga pari, propeta at hari ng Israel. Kaya pala ang paglalangis ay simbolo ng paghahanda para sa isang misyon. I think I have shared to you already na noong ako'y maordinahan bilang obispo, isang buong bote ng langis ang ibinuhos ni Cardinal Dency Rosales sa aking ulo. At talagang umagos. And it reminded me of the priest Aaron, who is referred to in the book of Psalms, like the oil on the head of Aaron, running down on his beard, dripping down on his collar. It is a very good image of the priest dripping with oil, so that whoever comes close to him is also anointed. Kaya siguro, parang batubalani ang pari. Lumalapit ang maraming tao sa kanya, nagmamano, ibig, lapitan, haplusin o hawakan, para din sila malangisan. Hindi lang pare ang pinapahira ng langis, kundi ang bawat Kristiyano. Kaya daladala natin ang Kristo sa ating pagkatao. Sa binyag, lahat tayo nalangisan. Ang bawat Kristiyano ay nakikibahagi sa pagkapari ni Kristo. We share in His priesthood by living our life as an offering, as a sacred gift, isang banal na handog na siyang ibig sabihin ng salitang Latin, sacerdos. Sacerdos. Banal na handog. Sacerdos. Ang pagkapari ng lumang tipan ay tungkol sa mga tagapag-alay ng mga hayop, mga tupa, kambing, baka, kinakatay upang gawing mga susunuging handog sa altar upang ipakipagkasundo ang tao sa Diyos. Dahil yun daw ang papel ng pare, tagapamagitan. Sa bagong tipan, binago ni Jesus ang kahulugan ng pagkapare. Ginawa niyang isa ang tagapaghandog ng hain at ang haing inihahandog ay hindi dapat mahiwalay. To offer our lives, our very lives, as sacred gifts acceptable to God in the name of the one priest, in the name of Jesus Christ, our high priest. Maraming beses nyo na ako narinig, paulit-ulit, ginigit ko, isa lang ang pare, si Kristo lamang. Pag hiniwalay natin kay Kristo ang ating pagkapare, wala nang saysay ito. This reminds me of that song that we used to sing in minor seminary, which is inspired by a speech delivered by the former UN Secretary General Dag Hammarskjöld. Ang pamagat ng kanta, "What shall I offer?" And the refrain says, "To you, I give my heart and soul and everything that's dear to me. For all that's been, I give you thanks. For all that's yet to come, amen. Make my life one continuous yes. Thy will be done." I have told you many times before that we are anointed not just to become Christians, but to become Christ. By that grace of our holy anointing at baptism, by the gift of the Holy Spirit, we become parts of the body of Christ, and therefore participants in the life and mission of Christ. The church is the corporate Christ. And so, our mission is to make Christ genuinely present in this world. Please, don't ever allow Christ to be reduced to a memory of the past. And when we, the ordained ministers of the church, repeat the words uttered by Christ, "This is my body. This is my blood." The possessive pronoun that we use is in the first person. We do not say, "This is his body." We do not say, "This is his blood." Di ba kayo kinikilabutan, mga kapatid na pare? At the moment of consecration, when you hold the bread and say, "This is my body." And sinabi mong "my," at that very moment, that's you. But that's supposed to be Christ in you. When we say these words, he becomes truly present in the Eucharistic bread and wine. And when we receive him, St. Augustine says, we do not change him, The way we digest ordinary food and transform the food to become part of our body. With the Eucharistic food, it is the other way around. When we receive Him, we are changed by Him. We are transformed by Him. We receive Him so that we can change and grow and become truly part of Christ. And if we are part of Christ, then we can dare to represent Christ. Please do not just talk about Christ. Be Christ. Let Christ talk and act and move about through you. Let me address myself now to my brothers in the ordained ministry. Dear brothers in the ordained priesthood, do not forget that you did not receive the anointing at ordination to monopolize the priesthood. Do not forget that the ordained priesthood has no other purpose than to promote the common priesthood, the participation of the faithful in the one priesthood of the Lord Jesus Christ, so that we are all configured to Him who is our unique high priest. In 2016, when I celebrated the Chrism Mass for the first time, I gave these points. Let me just repeat the basic points that I said in 2016 in different words. Three things. First of all, do not forget, my dear priests, ordained priests, people do not come to church to listen to your words. When people come to church, they listen to God's words through you. It is God's word they wish to hear from you. And so, be good ministers of the word. And that is said beautifully by St. Paul in his letter to Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 2 to 3. There, St. Paul said, proclaim the word, be persistent, whether convenient or inconvenient. Make it a point to convince, to reprimand, to encourage through all patience and teaching. For the time will come when people will not tolerate sound teaching. Following their own desires, however, and insatiable curiosity, they will go their own way and accumulate teachers. And so, make it a point, dear brothers, to soak in the Word of God. You cannot give what you do not have. You cannot give what you have not received. Before you can motivate your parishioners to be attentive to God's word, you yourselves must be attentive to God's word. Even if studying the word of God is important, let your most important preparation for your homilies be your prayer. Prayer. I tell you, mahirap manatiling pare nang hindi nagdadasal. And always ask not what you want to say. Ask God what He wants to say to His people through you. Remember, it is not your words that matter, but His words. From the first ordination you received at your diaconate, you have already been entrusted with the Word of God. A few days ago, we ordained 4 new deacons for the Diocese of Caloocan. And once again, you heard the first instruction about being heralds, stewards of the Word of God. Now that part where the bishop says to the ordinand, receive the Word of God, whose herald you now are. And don't forget 3 things. Believe what you read. Believe what you read. Don't just read. Take it to heart. Believe it. And don't teach. So, yung pangalawa is teach what you believe. Teach only what you believe. Don't teach what you do not believe. But most of all, practice what you teach. Let the Word of God take flesh in you. Secondly, dear brother priests, proclaim the Word of God as good news, as a message of hope, a message that empowers, a message that uplifts, a message that inspires. Don't ever start by telling people that they are bad. I know sometimes we fall into moralizing, sounding like we're holier than anybody else. But that is not what preaching the good news is about. So please don't ever start by telling people they're bad. Even when we fail, the good news is we can always do better. Hindi ba yun yung sinasabi nung kantang Hey Jude? You can take a sad song and make it better. Make it better and better and better. That's good news. Assure people that every saint has a past, but every sinner has a future. Na mas interesado ang Panginoon sa atin ngayon at bukas kaysa sa ating kahapon. Gaano mang kadilim ang kahapon natin. Hindi niya tayo ipapako sa mga kapalpakan ng nakaraan. Lagi siyang magbubukas ng pintuan para sa isang bagong bukas, para sa mga bagong pagkakataon. And so each time you preach a homily, ask, anong good news ang ibig ipahayag ng Diyos sa aking bayan, sa kanyang bayan ngayon? Do not forget, this is what we have been anointed for, to evangelize, which means to proclaim an evangelion, a good news. Pope Francis reminds us that evangelium, which is gospel in Latin, and gaudium, which is joy in Latin, they always go together. Remember his encyclical Evangelii Gaudium. They always go together. It cannot be gospel if it doesn't have joy, if it does not communicate joy. The prayer attributed to Saint Francis sums it up very well. Where there is hatred, we bring love. Where there is injury, we bring pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. And finally, to be anointed in the priesthood of Christ is to say, this scripture is fulfilled. Our endeavor is to not just proclaim the scripture, but to bring it to fulfillment. So seek to actualize the Word of God. Even if it was a long time ago that it was written, let it address the present moment. Let it address people in the here and now. Which means, if you soak in the Word of God, we must also immerse in the human condition, especially in the longings and aspirations of the people we serve. We cannot preach God's Word to them if we do not know them, if we do not listen to their longings and aspirations, if we do not feel what they feel, if we do not suffer when they suffer, and if we cannot partake in their joy. Isaiah's words were a projection into the future. And Jesus changed everything the moment he said, today, this scripture passage is fulfilled. Today. That's the good news, to fulfill the scripture, that the dream of tomorrow can be realized today. That the scripture is not just a utopian vision of something not real or something idealistic. That the scripture can take flesh in the here and now. After all, remember that God did not introduce himself to Moses as I was. Neither did he say, I will be. When Moses said, what will I say to the people when they ask who you are? And God said, I am. That is the name of God. I am. Not I was. Not I will be. Jesus did not preach about a future kingdom. Rather, he announced God's kingdom coming among us. And so he taught us to make that kingdom present. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. We often dream of going to God's kingdom. Do not forget, the desire is greater on the part of God to come among us. Thy will be done. And he means now, here on earth, as it is in heaven. And the daily bread that we ask for is for today. Let us give that bread always, the bread of the Word, so that our people will never go hungry. Baunin ninyo, mga kapatid, itong tatlong bagay. Proclaim God's Word, not your own. Pangalawa, proclaim it as good news. Bring joy, give hope. And pangatlo, proclaim this good news in the here and now. Let tomorrow start today. Ipahayag natin ang dito sa lupa ay simula na ng langit.